السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. Welcome my dear brothers and sisters. May Allah سبحانه وتعالى bless our meeting and may Allah عز وجل benefit us from whatever we say, whatever we hear, whatever we learn. Make this knowledge beneficial for us in this life and in the next one, and testify for us at the day of judgment, and give us the help to practice whatever we learn. Barakallah fikum. Today, inshallah, we will continue our study for ayat from Surah Al-Baqarah. And today, inshallah, we'll go in the ayah number 237. But before we go to this ayah, I just would like to remind you about the ayah before. Now, this is the ayah that we will study today. وَإِنْ طَلَّقْتُمُوهُنَّ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ تَمَسُّوهُنَّ وَقَدْ فَرَضْتُمْ لَهُنَّ فَرِيضَةً فَنِصْفُ مَا فَرَضْتُمْ إِلَّا أَنْ يَعْفُونَ أَوْ يَعْفُوَ الَّذِي بِيَدِهِ عُقْدَةُ النِّكَاحِ وَإِنْ تَعْفُوا أَقْرَبُ لِلتَّقْوَى وَلَا تَنْسَوُا الْفَضْلَ بَيْنَكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرٌ. And the meaning or translation of the meaning of this ayah as you see it, and if you divorce them, that means your wives, women, before you have touched them, that means no relation with them, and you have already specified for them an obligation, then give half of what you specified unless they forego the right, or the one in whose hand is the marriage contract forgoes it. And to forego or to forego it, it is nearer to righteousness. And do not forget graciousness between you. Indeed, Allah of whatever you do is seen. To understand this ayah, just to connect it with the ayah which we explained last week, and the ayah that we talk about, ayah 236 last week, which said, لَا جُنَاحَ عَلَى, there is no harm, no sin on you if you divorce women, مَا لَمْ تَمَسُّهُنَّ أَوْ تَفْرِضُ لَهُنَّ فَرِيضَةً, that you never, you didn't touch them, or even you didn't assign the specific amount of dowry for them. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla say, وَمَتِّعُهُنَّ عَلَى الْمُوسِعِ قَدَرُهُ وَعَلَى الْمُقْتِرِ قَدَرُهُ, then you should just give them a gift for the one to the best of his ability. And Allah Azza wa Jalla this is right over those who intend to be good doers. Now the connection between this ayah will explain, because here there are four different cases, and I will go back to this after we just first of all go through this ayah, which is of our subject today, and explain it as you can see. So this is the ayah that we are going to study, inshallah. And then let's go through the meaning of this ayah. The ayah said, if you divorce them before you have touched them. Now, the meaning of touch here, it's not just the physical touch, but it's mean that either you have seclusion with them, that's mean you were with her privately, that's mean when the person signed a contract of marriage, and then he got the chance to be with his wife alone, or he have relation, sexual intercourse with her, which is between the husband and wife. So as we said before, in the Quran and almost in the Arabic culture, whenever there's something which is people which is seem to them, it is not right to say it clearly. So they mention it by a term or a statement. And this is why it here is mentioned touch. They didn't say sexual intercourse, say touch. And this why, because that's mean touch between the two sides. So this is the point here. So, and then Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying here, if you have specified for them a dowry, why it is specified, why is mentioned specified? Because sometimes people, they agree in dowry, because this is, in fact, it is one of the condition or one of the requirement for the contract of marriage, that there should be a dowry. But in some community, people, they don't, you know, want to show that they are like to specify or to ask the husband to pay a specific dowry. So they leave it for him. And sometimes people, they assign this before the contract, or sometimes they leave it, and then after the marriage, he will give her the dowry which was not specified before. So here we have four situations. Either to specify the amount of dowry by saying that, you know, I will marry your sister or your daughter, and I will pay 10,000 as a dowry for her. Or he doesn't specify it. And then in this two situation, he already get married with her and they have relation. The third situation, the fourth situation, which is mentioned in this ayah and previous ayah. The previous ayah, which we studied last week, it said that if you divorce her, divorce your wife, after you sign the contract of marriage, before you touch her, just you accept, you sign the contract, there had been agreement, it was documented legally, and then there was a plan to, you know, for next week or next month, and then you change your mind for any reason, you know, that show up, and then you decide not to continue in this project, and then you want to divorce her. So in this case, you already, last previous I said, you already assign or specify certain amount of dowry by saying 5,000. Now in this ayah, it said that if you divorce them, but before, after you assign for them a dowry. So this is two other cases. And we'll come to this, inshallah, to compare between all this at the end to summarize what we said. So in this ayah, Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying, and you have specified for them a dowry, means that you have determined a dowry for them, such as 10,000, 5,000, whatever. For example, see, the phrase in is very clear that you specified this compared to the previous ayah, which didn't say that you conduct the marriage contract, but without having a specific amount to give as a dowry. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla said, then half of what you have is specified. Then now a person, as we said, he already agreed, he made contract, he gave the woman and her family the dowry of 10,000 riyal. But then he divorced her before he touched her, before he has a chance to be in private with her. So this ayat said, then half of what you have specified. That's mean now she has to take half of this dowry. It is her. And then that's mean the other half, 50%, should be returned to you. So indicate that it is obligation to give half of what you have specified, which is, except then, Allah Azza wa Jalla made exception, said, except if they forgive you. This is an exception, which means the rules is that you should leave 50%, half of the dowry, and you take back 50%. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has opened the way for good treatment, build good relation, kindness between the two sides. And then he said, except that if you want to leave it for them, this is from the man side or from the woman's side. That's one of these two sides, you know, decided to give up his right and give the other half to the other party. So this is what's mentioned in the ayah, or the one in whose hand is marriage contract. Who's the one here? This refer to the husband. Why? Because he is the one who have control in the marriage contract, either, you know, to end it or to make it go or to confirm it, because he's the one who can divorce. So, as I said, or the one in whose has his marriage. So this refers to the husband. So, but some ulama, some scholars in explaining this ayah say it could be the guardian of the woman. So now they say there this ayah refer either to the husband or to the guardian of the woman, because now he's have control because they took the dowry. But it is more likely, or which is said, that the more correct view or the more sound view, that this refers to the husband. Why? Because the guardian may not have the authority to give any of this back. Why? Because this is the right of his daughter or sister. That means the right of the woman, not the right of the guardian. Therefore, if it was for her, Allah Azza wa Jal will say, mention her. But here it said, whose, that's mean mention the husband who has the power or the right to make the divorce. And then when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, so when referring to the husband, forgiveness can come from both sides, which means either from the wife, as indicated by the verse, except if they forgo, that's mean the family of the wife here. If the woman said, when she learned that this man, before he touched her, before he have any relation with her, you know, said, I give up, I'm not going to continue in this marriage, you are divorced. And the woman said, okay, take your dowry, I don't want any penny. Now she's the one who show kindness here. And this is her right. She can give up, she can return it back. Or on the other side, the man himself, he said, you are divorced, but don't get me back half of the dowry. All of the dowry is, you know, to you. I mean, he's talking for the guardian, with the guardian of the woman. He said, okay, I divorce, but I don't need you to return to me anything. So from both sides, this kindness can come. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned about the marriage in a way by saying the marriage contract. Now, what is the meaning when Allah Azza wa Jalla referred to the marriage as a contract? It's very important. Why? Because there's different application for this statement. This to show that the marriage, in fact, same like any other contract. And always when we talk about contract here, that means binding an agreement between two parties, like in this marriage, like for example, sale between the seller or the buyer. This bind an agreement between two sides, This is why the marriage, you know, called as contract of marriage. Why? Because it is between two sides, and also because it's include rights and obligation in both sides. This is why it's considered like contract. I agree with you to give me this, and I agree with you that I will do this for you. the same thing from the other side. This is why Allah Azza wa Jal call it marriage contract. And here is one question that rise that, you know, and this about the options. Since we say the marriage contract, does this mean that it is similar to other contract, like the contract of when we talk about sale or buying or any other contract, which mean we can include some conditions, we can cancel it, we can extend it, all this big question. But what we are here, make sure that both party, that's mean the husband and the wife, they should understand that marriage is contract, which mean that every one of them, both side, every side, he should fulfill his obligation toward the other side, and at the same time, he will get his right in this contract. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that if there is any condition in any contract, including the contract of marriage, then it should be what? It should be taken in account. That means should not be neglected, should not be just forgotten. This is very, very important to understand. That means if the husband agree in any condition that was made by the woman or by her family when he signed the marriage contract, then he should respect this condition. For example, if the woman said, or her family, okay, you can marry her, but we already have place at home because her mother is an old lady and would like her to live in the house of her mother so she can take care of her. This condition. Now the husband, he has the option before the marriage contract, before signing it, by saying, okay, I don't mind. She can stay, she can live with, you know, with her mother. Or her mother can live with her. Or he can say from the beginning, no, you know, when I get married, I want to take her to my home. So here is a contract, I mean, a condition. So if the husband accepted, then he should respect it. That's me later on, if he decide not to respect it, the family of the woman, they have the right to end the contract. Why? Because this person, the husband, violate the contract, I mean, the conditions which was included in the contract when he signed it. Right. So here, as we said, for example, you know, some women, they may make a condition. They said one condition that I should live in the city of my family. I cannot move to another city. And then the husband didn't respect. He said, no, you have to, he want to move her to another city. Now, what is the outcome of this disagreement? Now the right for the woman, either that she said okay and she accept this, or because she put this condition at the beginning, she said I'm sorry, so just let's not end this marriage. So she has the right either to forgive, to continue her marriage, or not, because she is the one who put this condition. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and forgive is closer to piety. That's mean Allah Azza wa Jal encourage both sides, the husband and the wife of her family, to be deal with each other nicely and with kindness. So either one, he can give up his right of the other half of the dowry. And Allah Azza wa Jalla said, and don't forget the favor between you also. Don't forget. Remember, you know, that good relation that you have before, that some favor, good relation that you live, especially as neighbor or as relatives or as friends before. Therefore, it is Allah Azza wa Jalla is reminding us, because Islam emphasizes the importance of good relation and harmony in the Muslim community. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is warning, whenever Allah Azza wa Jal remind us about any of his rules, always reminding us about his power, about his ability, about his great attributes. So we know that we deal with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not dealing with somebody else. So here saying, indeed, Allah is aware of what you do. Whatever you are doing, if you are doing good, Allah is aware for this, with this, and will forgive you and grant you reward for this. And if it's the opposite, be careful that you could be punished for what the wrong that you are doing. Now let's, as a conclusion here, before we go to study the benefit of this ayah, to talk and explain this poor situation regarding the marriage contract and the dowry. There are four. The first one, when a person, a man, he marry a woman, and he specified certain amount of dowry by saying that, or by signing in the contract, that he give 10,000 riyals as a dowry for her. And then he continued his marriage life, so they live together. Okay, they have relation, and he already have, he get, specified 10,000 for her. In this situation, if he divorce her, what is the outcome? If he divorce her, then he has no right to take back anything from this dowry. This means the full amount will be the right of the woman. More than this, at the time of divorce, it is recommended, he is encouraged also to give a gift for her. This is for the person who specified the dowry, and then he divorced her after having relation. The second situation, he didn't specify dowry at the time of signing the contract. And also he have relation and they live together for a time. And then he divorced her. Now, how much dowry that she should take, because it was not specified in the contract. In this case, she is entitled to take the amount similar to women's like her in her community. Here we are look at the custom in this community. For example, in this community, that people they give, it is known that people they give 10,000 or 15,000 or between 20 and 30. So he give her something which is similar, known in the community that this is the type or the amount of dowry that should be given. She should take it for. Why? Because he has relation. And besides this, he give her a gift of at the end of the marriage. Now, the third situation is if the person, he specified the amount of the dowry by saying, you know, he in the contract was mentioned that the woman will take 10,000 as a dowry. But then he divorced her before he touched her. Now, he get, as we said, explained in this ayah, he will get back half of the dowry that he paid for them. And if he didn't, in this case, both sides, they have the right to forgive. And Allah Azza wa Jalla encourage them to deal nicely with each other. So either the woman will give up and said, okay, don't give me anything, okay? Or the man, he will say, don't return to me 50, I mean half of the dowry. The fourth one is, if he signed the marriage of contract, but the dowry was not mentioned here. The amount of dowry was not mentioned. So what should he give? Here he give nothing. But he should give what? He give a gift at the end of, at the time of divorce. So these are the four situations. Now let's go to the benefit or lesson that we learned from this ayat. So we said, if a man divorces his wife before consummation and has specified the dowry, she is entitled to have of the dowry. Second, if he secluded, that's mean privately with her, but has not consummated the marriage, he only owes half of the dowry. The same thing. The permissibility of divorce before consummation while specifying the dowry. That means it is no sin on the person if he decides to divorce. But as we said, here the ayat of the Quran explain the rights of all parties. Specifying the dowry is husband's responsibility, not the wife. That means it is the man who decide the amount that he give. It's maybe, you know, the woman or her family at the beginning, at the time of negotiation, they can ask for a certain amount. But the one who decides what amount that he gives is the husband. It is permissible for a woman to waive her dowry or part of it, provided she is free, mature, and sane. This is the most important, that she can make decision. And this to show you that in Islam, the woman is the one who control her wealth and her money and her business. It's not right for the husband, for example, or the father or the brother, if his wife or his daughter or his sister have money, that he have power on her, how to spend it or how to use it or how to invest it. He may give advice, but the only one who has the right to deal with this money is the woman herself. And this to show you, my dear brothers and sisters, how much Islam is advanced, even, you know, from many laws at this time. There are many countries, many laws in different places. They don't give the woman the freedom to deal with her money in the way that she like. There's some authority, either for her husband or father or someone else. The woman can manage her wealth even if as a gift. The permissibility to the for the husband waiving what remain of dowry if divorced before consummation. As we said, both sides have this right. Marriage is contract. And based on this, it is permissible to appoint someone to conduct the marriage contract, and the Prophet ﷺ appointed people for contracts. What does this mean? That means it is okay to assign an agent to act in your behalf, to conclude this marriage. Let's say, for example, a person in a country far away, and the woman in other country, and they want to sign the marriage contract. So both sides, they have who have the right to sign the contract, can assign representative or an agent to sign the contract in their behalf. For example, the husband, maybe he asks someone in the country where the woman is and tell him, send him, it should be very clear, lawful certificate, that's mean certified letter from the court or any other way that say that I assign so and so as my representative or my agent to sign the marriage, my marriage of contract. And then he gets this certificate or this agreement and he show it to the family of the woman. So when they come at the time of marriage contract, so that the man or the guardian of the woman, he will say this exactly. He will say to this man, the agent, I give my daughter as a wife for the person who, for so and so, who assign you as you, as an agent to sign for him. And this person, the agent, will say, I accept in the name of my client that he accepts her as a wife. It's very carefully, you know, these words and this statement at the time of the sign of the contract should be very clear, not make a mistake, you know, to go and then tell the agent that I give my daughter for you as, and then the person maybe he changes his mind and he marry her instead of his, the one who assigned him as. So this is very, very important to realize and remember in this situation. But the point here is that it is permissible. The same way, for example, that the guardian of the woman, he may give authority or authorize someone to act in his name as a guardian for his daughter or his sister. Right. Second, the option of conditions is permissible in marriage. Why? Because as we said, it is a type of contract. Therefore, both parties, I mean the husband and the wife, before they sign the marriage contract, they can ask for any condition they want. But it's very important that should be legal conditions. That means it doesn't contradict with the teaching of Islam. Like, for example, if the person, the man said, I will put the condition that you should not put or wear hijab. You should go outside with your hair without any hijab. This condition is not valid. Why? Because this condition is not right. It is contradict with the Islamic teaching. But if it is acceptable condition, you know, and then here depend on the other party. As we said, for example, the husband said, I want you to live with me in my city. And they accept this. Okay, this is okay. Generally understood that when the husband or the man married, he will take his wife to his place. This is why the condition here in this situation come from the side of the woman. She said, okay, look, you or the family said, look, you are living in Riyadh or Dammam. And here, and we are in Jeddah, for example. And this woman or this girl, she has a mother that she needs her help. So we have one condition that she should live with her mother or she should stay here in this city. Now the husband has the right, said, okay, I accept this. And then he will travel and come back. Or he said, no, sorry, I don't accept this. So he will not sign the contract, the marriage contract. But if he accepts it, he should respect it. He doesn't accept it and said, okay. And then after the marriage contract finished and they married and lived together, he said, okay, now you are my wife. I will take with me. He has no right to say this. In this case, the woman has the right, what? To release or to cancel this marriage contract. The next point, encouragement for forgiveness found in the verse. Allah Azza wa Jal encourage people in this way to be more nice and kind to each other. Deeds are ranked according to righteousness. That's mean the more you do good deeds, this will, we will, by the will of Allah, elevate you to be more righteous. And this, my dear brothers and sisters, if you want to get more near to Allah Azza wa Jal. You have more piety. You have more. You want to strengthen your iman, strengthen your faith. Then you should do more of the good deeds. One should not forget to show kindness in dealing with it. And the encompassing knowledge and vision of Allah Azza wa Jal, we should remember and learn about the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we should increase of the goodness. Now let's go to the next ayah. قال عز وجل in ayah number 239 and 239. And here we are studying two ayat, two verses. حافظوا على الصلوات والصلاة الوسطى وقوموا لله قانتين فإن خفتم فرجالا أو ركبانا فإذا أمنتم فاذكروا الله كما علمكم ما لم تكونوا تعلمون. The meaning of this ayah, or these two ayat, observe or maintain the five obligatory prayers, especially the middle prayer, and stand in true devotion sincerely to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The next ayah, if you are in danger or fear, pray on foot. That means while you are standing or walking or while riding, like riding, you know, car or camel, aircraft or whatever. But when you are safe, take time to remember Allah for teaching you what you didn't know. Now let's go to the meaning of this great ayat. And this is very important ayat because it's talk about the second pillar of Islam, which is as-salah. طيب. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here, some people they ask, what is the wisdom? Look at this question. Allah Azza wa Jal for previous ayat talking about marriage, about divorce, about waited period, about relation between men and women in marriage. And now come this two ayah in the middle of this, because the following ayat, it will return again to talk about the waited period of the widow. So some people, they ask, okay, what's the wisdom behind this? There are, or there is for sure a wisdom, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the great, the most wise. Sometimes we don't know about the wisdom, but sometimes we may figure it out through other, you know, statement or a hadith or any other clues to know something about this wisdom. But what's important here, some ulama, they said, since Allah Azza wa Jalla was talking about divorce and, you know, about separation between the husband and wife, and, you know, as people, as a human being, we know that this situation is not, you know, a situation of rest. It is a situation when the person facing calamity, facing troubles, you know, he will break from his wife, or the woman will break from her husband. So they feel under pressure. So as Allah Azza wa Jal here reminding us, after talk about all these, now you are on this, you know, atmosphere or this situation of troubles, remember that the best way, the best gate for you to get out of this situation is what? Prayer. And remembering of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what confirmed this concept is what the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam used to do. It is mentioned in the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam, whenever he faced troubles or he is under pressure or in any very difficult situation, always he turned to salah, to prayers. And this will give relief. So the Muslim always, my dear brothers and sisters, whenever you find yourself under stress, frustrated, facing problems, facing troubles, couldn't go, you know, to anybody else but to go Allah, to Allah. How? By prayer. Pray at night, pray voluntarily prayer, recite the Quran, remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because this is the only or the best way to get relief. And this way Allah Azza wa Jalla said, wasta'inu bis sabr was salah. Seek help in what? In prayer. And what? And patience. Patience and prayer. This is why some ulama, they said, Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned salah here, reminding us about it and about the importance of salah, because it is the source of rest and relief for the believer. So, in this ayah, Allah Azza wa Jalla said, and observe or maintain the prayer. What does it mean? That means continuously preserving something with care. That means you should take good care of your prayer. Now, what does it mean when I said took good care of the prayer? That means do it on the prescribed time. Meet all the conditions. You should have the good or the right wudu, what you call it, they call it ablution. You should be ready for it. You should put it in your calendar. You should, for example, if you sleep, you should put a clock or something to remind you about your prayer, especially nowadays. You know, people sometimes when they are watching program in the TV or they're working in their computer, and especially if there's no, you know, voice, you cannot hear the adhan, maybe the time of the prayer will pass and then you will look and it is already, you know, the time is over. So remind yourself. So taking care of the prayer, that means you take all the means to do it in time, to be ready for it, to prepare yourself for it, not only we talk about this physical, but also with your mind. And this is why it is always encouraged that the Muslim go to the masjid early, not go late and run. So when he reached the masjid, he was already exhausted, tired. It's not the same as if you came early. So this is the meaning here, that you should keep it and you should do it in the right way that was done by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And then the Allah Azza wa Jal emphasized the importance of the middle prayer. And the middle prayer here, as mentioned, you know, in some of the views of the ulama, that it is the Asr prayer, the afternoon prayer, yeah, before Maghrib. This is the prayer which is called the middle prayer, which is the most important. Some ulama, they say it is the Fajr, because the word wusta in Arabic, it doesn't, you know, exactly mean the middle. Wusta, that's mean is the best here, the preferred. So this is another meaning for wusta. So some ulama, they said it is the Fajr, the dawn. And others, they said it is al-Asr. Which one is more sound? Those who say al-Asr. Why? Because there is evidence in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned one hadith at the time of Ghazwat al-Ahzab, mentioned that about Salat al-Asr as the middle prayer. And then Allah Azza wa Jal said the meaning, stand for Allah, devoutly obedient. Truth point. That's mean, stand, وَقُومُوا لِلَّهِ قُومُوا لِلَّهِ, stand for Allah, قانتين. Now two words here. Stand, قُومُوا, that's mean standing, وَقَانِت. Now these two words have different meaning. Now standing, it's very normal. That's mean standing, not sitting. But qanitin, it's come in the meaning of standing also. Qanit, that's mean standing. And also it's meaning that you do it with very attentive heart. That's mean sincerely to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Humiliate yourself in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Concentrating And another third meaning, which is related to the reason of this ayah, as mentioned in the books of tafsir, that before people, I mean the Muslim, at the time of salah, they used to speak during the salah. That means they are praying, and you know, the one next to him, he may ask you, okay, how are you doing? Are you going somewhere? And like our talk at the beginning. And then when Allah Azza wa Jalla revealed this ayah, the Prophet ﷺ explained to them that they should not speak during the salah. So this is one of the other meaning here, which is related to the meaning of qanitin. So regarding standing now, is it must in all type of prayers? No. When, regarding obligatory prayer, it is must. In fact, one of the pillars. That means if the person, he can pray while he's stand, and he didn't stand, then his salah is not valid. His salah is not valid because he should stand up and pray while he's standing. There are some exceptions regarding when the person may not stand in the salah, because standing is a pillar. And when we say a pillar, that means if the person didn't do it, then the salah is not valid. But we said, as the ayah mentioned here, there is exception. And this exception, one, the voluntary prayers. What does it mean? Optional prayer. So if the Muslim at night, at any time, he's tired, he wants to pray extra prayer, sunnah, and he's sitting instead of standing, no harm, it's acceptable. But the reward will be half. Be careful. The reward of the one who prays sitting while he's able to stand is half the reward. The person who do it standing. This involuntarily prayer, an optional prayer. But for obligatory prayer, there's no way for the person who's able but to pray while he's standing. The second excuse is fear, as is mentioned in this ayah, that if you fear, if you have fear, then this fear, either from danger, that, for example, you are praying in some place and then you hear a voice coming from there, wild animal or enemy, or maybe flood is coming or something is, and you want to move, then you can move, okay? You fear, for example, if you pray while standing, that your enemy, they can see you, or the animal, wild animal may can see you, and then it's okay, you know, to sit and pray while sitting so nobody will see you or discover your place. So this is another excuse, and this allowed even an obligatory prayer. So this is exception. Same like, for example, a person, he is in the aircraft and you are now in your seat, and the captain said that everyone should fasten his seat belt. You have no choice. There's a command from the captain. Then you should do it. And then you cannot stand to pray. You stand while you are sitting, it's okay. Here, this is an example of excuse. Inability, the same as we said, if you are in the aircraft, or a person who is sick, who have problem with his knees, an old person, he cannot pray while he's standing, also is forgiven, and it is permissible for him praying while he is sitting. There is unique situation when the imam who is leading the prayer is sitting. Should people behind him, and they are able to pray while they are standing or sitting? This is a very good question. Be careful about this. Because it's happened during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one time, he was praying, and there are people who pray with him. So he was praying, sitting, and they stand. So he mentioned to them with his hand, that means sit, sit. So they sat. And then he told them, he said that the Imam was pointed to be followed. That means we should follow the Imam. So if he pray while he's standing, then he should stand behind him. If he prayed while he was sitting, then he should sit. Now, some people, they will ask, okay, this the Imam, he has an excuse. But this person who pray behind him, he has no excuse. In this way, the ulama said, there's different situation. The first one is, for example, let's say that in your community, this man who leads the prayer, he's the only one, or he is the more knowledgeable person, or he is the regular imam of the masjid, and then he started the salah. He cannot stand at all. He started the salah while he's sitting. Then in this case, they start everyone after him, behind him, he should pray while he's sitting. They should not stand. But as we said, it is highly recommended here that he should replace someone to lead the prayer. Lead the prayer. Why? Because people behind them, when we sit, they will pray while sitting. So in this case, we said it is preferable, it is encouraged, and is also to get out of the different views related to this issue. The other situation, if the imam started the prayer as usual, standing, and at the middle of the prayer, after he prayed the first rak'ah, in the second rak'ah, he has something in his knees, problems, he couldn't stand up. So he continued his prayer sitting. What should people behind him do? They should continue standing. Now, where we got this from? We get it from the story of the prayer, the last of prayer of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Muslim, before the Prophet sallallahu was very sick before he passed away. And so the Prophet sallallahu wasallam told the people, tell Abu Bakr to lead the prayer. So they started the prayer, and Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he was the imam, and he was standing in front of them. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after they started the prayer, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam felt some strength. So he joined the prayer and he sat in the left side of Abu Bakr to lead the prayer. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was leading the prayer while he's sitting. Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he was leading the people based on the prayer of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the ulama concluded from this that when the imam started the prayer in a normal way, standing, then those who behind him, they should continue standing, even the imam was not able to continue. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla, when he said devoutly, obedient, the term true devotion, that can mean several matters. Include continuous worship and obedience, keeping the prayer. It also referred to humility and quietness, and speaking, concentrating on the prayer, shown by, as we mentioned, this historical context, that's mean not speaking during the salah. And then the ayah, when it said, if you fear, then this exception that we mentioned, this means it is fear of harm, of danger, of enemy. Then you are excused not to stand in your prayer. And then Allah gave different option that while you are walking on your foot, while you are riding in a car, as we said, if you are in a car with a plane and you want to pray while sitting, it's okay. For what? For optional prayer. But for obligatory prayer, only at the time of need, either because of fear or inability. And then when Allah Azza wa Jalla said, when you are saved, then that means, okay, this reason which made you sit while you should stand is over now. What should you do? You should not continue sitting. In the next prayer, you should go back and do the salah in the perfect way as we learn it from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who said, صلوا كما رأيتموني وصلي. Pray the same way that you saw me pray. So this is the meaning that we should retain, which means this is exception from the general rule. And then Allah Azza wa Jal said, and remember Allah as He taught you. We should remember the blessing of Allah Azza wa Jal that He taught us all this, how to worship Him. It is very important how to do our obligation toward Him. Because the person, if he didn't learn this knowledge, that means he will not do the ibadah, the acts of worship, in the correct way. This is why Allah Azza wa Jal, He revealed a book for us to learn, and also He sent a messenger as a teacher, as a practical example, as a practical example for us to follow. This is why the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, صَلُّوا كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي وَصَلِّي. Say, pray the same way that you are seeing me pray. Or خذوا عني مناسككم. طيب, let's go now to some of the benefit that we learned from this ayatain, two ayat. The obligation to maintain the prayers as indicated by Allah's statement, maintain the prayer or preserve or guard your prayer. The virtue of Salatul Asr, just should the person took care of this, as and we said the Prophet ﷺ mentioned the virtue of this salah in different hadith. It highlights the obligation of standing in a prayer. As we said, standing is what? Is one of the pillar of the salah. They emphasize the necessity of sincerity to Allah. Allah Azza wa Jal, you know, accept from you if you are sincere. Because remember, we said many times, there are two conditions, two important conditions for any act of ibadah to be accepted by Allah. If he didn't meet this condition, then this ibadah will not be accepted. What are they? The first condition is sincerity, that you do your prayer, your fasting, whatever good deeds that you do it, sincerely for the sake of Allah, seeking the pleasure of Allah, not seeking the pleasure of anybody else or praising from people. This is the first condition. And second is what? To follow the example of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It is important for a person to feel the command of Allah when worshiping Him. That means you remember that this is command. And who is the one who commanded you? Your creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The verses also command being submissive to Allah, which involve having humble heart, and manifest instilling limbs. That means when the person pray, he should be very quiet. He should have tranquility. And this is why some ulama, they including tranquility, is one of the pillar of the salah. That means if the person he pray, his prayer without tranquility, it's not valid. It is null. Now, what does it mean? That means an excessive, unnecessary movement. A person, he's praying, but he sometimes he opened his mobile, put it in his pocket, playing with his, clothes, which means anybody will, when he see him, he doesn't think that he's praying. So this is the meaning of tranquility here. It is prohibited speaking during the prayer. It's not right to speak. It is mandatory to stand in prayer. It is must, as we said, and there's only a certain exception. We discuss it in detail. We summarize it in these four. Voluntary prayers, even the person is able to stand, it is okay to pray while you are sitting. At the situation of fear, of any reason or any cause, inability, the person, if he's unable because he's sick or he has problems with his knees or he cannot stand for any other, or following the imam if he pray while sitting, and we explain that there are two situations. If the imam started the prayer sitting, those who pray behind him, they should pray while sitting. If he started the prayer standing, and then during the prayer he was not able to continue and he sat, then they should continue while they are standing. The best mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah make it easy for us. He didn't, you know, command us to do something beyond our ability. So he excused the person that he do the prayer to the best of his ability. It is permissible to move a lot during the prayer out of necessity, if there is need, not without any reason. It is allowed to pray while riding in times of fear. You are running from an enemy, like in a war, for example, and you are in your ride, whatever, car, whatever, it's okay to pray in this ride. The obligation to perform worship in full ones that excuse remove. That means if there is exception, the reason for not to doing the salah in the perfect way is over, then you should not continue. A person who was sick and now, mashallah, he can't stand, then he should pray while standing. The prayer is a form of remembering Allah Azza wa Jal. In fact, it is the best form of remembering Allah. It showed the favor of Allah that he granted us the knowledge. It highlights the necessity due to the natural state of ignorance. We as a human being, we born as ignorance. No one born with knowledge. And to know this, just take any baby of a human being and leave him in the jungle. What he will learn? That even he will not have any human language to speak. Why? Because it is the nature of man. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala emphasized the importance of knowledge and that we should learn for our class today, and inshallah we'll see you next week. But we leave some. I'm sorry that we take about 5 or a few minutes more. Now we'll leave some time for your questions. Before we remind you tomorrow, inshallah, tomorrow Sunday at 7:30, we will resume our fiqh class. Resume our fiqh class. Remember, we stopped in Ramadan explaining narrations from the book of Bulugh al-Maram, and we are talking about food. And tomorrow, inshallah, we'll continue about our class. Nah. So leave your any questions.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Dr. Yahya, we have questions from our participants. Okay. First one, she's asking if the contract says the wife family wants her to look after her mom and the husband agreed. Later, the husband decided to go against the contract and the wife goes along with her husband and lives with the husband. Can the family break the marriage?
Well, this is the condition is for the lady that she has the right, okay? I mean, she is the one who has the right either to break the marriage contract or to waive it and go with her husband. It's not the right of the family, the guardian.
Tayyip, another question, Dr. Yahya. Islam gives the right to the father to take his son's money, but the father has no right over his daughter's money or wealth. Is her understanding correct? This is what she's saying.
Well, I think there is misunderstanding. When the Prophet ﷺ said, "Anta wa maluka li abi," that doesn't mean the father have full authority over the money or the wealth of his son. In case that only, the meaning here is that if the father is in need, and the son or even the daughter, they has ability to spend on him, then it is obligation on them to take care of them. But doesn't mean that if the person, I mean this father, is alhamdulillah wealthy and he has enough money to live and he is not in need to go and control or take the money of his son. No.
طيب. Another one, Dr. Yahya, if you marry a pious man, but you know, with other sect, this is what she's asking, can a woman make a condition that he will not intervene with your religious belief and not follow his beliefs, not join their prayer
please say
and
it,
gathering?
say it again, sister. I
okay.
didn't hear the beginning of the question, please.
Okay, her question is, if you marry a pious man, but he has another sect, okay, can a woman make a condition that he will not intervene with your religious belief and not follow his belief, not I also not joining their prayer and gathering? Is it permissible in Islam? I mean, is it acceptable?
Are both Muslim or you mean from different religion? You mean
Probably
they
the
are
question, it says probably same, but maybe another sect, probably Sufi or probably Shia, something like that.
Well, no, this is, you see, here is different. Okay, as we said, this depends on what sect. For example, let's say the woman or the husband is, he has some bid'ah. And he said, look, I will keep this, I believe this is correct. And it is very clear with the evidence. I mean, it's not a matter of debatable. You know, there is some issue which is debatable. That's mean the same issue, it has different views. No problem with this. But there's something which is very clear, like bid'ah, which is in the deen. For example, if the person, he used to go visit grave and make dua there. From the beginning, the family of the woman, if a man come from this way and they know that and believe that this is shirk and this is haram, they should not accept the proposal for marriage in this case from the beginning. Okay? This type of condition is not applicable here. Why? Because if it is a matter of opposite, as we said, the only conditions which are accepted and approved, the conditions that does not contradict with the teaching of Islam. Now, regarding these differences, that, like, for example, mostly you find it among the Sunnah, for example, between the Hanafi or Shafi'i, sometimes it is in very minor matters. Like, for example, holding hand in the prayer or not holding hand, or putting, covering the head or not covering the head. This is very minor things, okay? And it's, there's no need to put conditions like this. Why? Because everybody, both inshallah, are in the rights. This follow a dalil and evidence from one respected and known scholar, and the other side also respect, or he choose to take the dalil from other scholar, and there's no difference in this. Nah. So there's no need to have conditions like this. Nah.
Dr. Yahya, for example, is it contradict when the woman put in her contract, I mean, include in her contract, that a man should not marry another wife? For example, usually I heard some of the women here, especially in Saudi Arabia, they put this kind of condition, just like
yes,
what you've mentioned before, for as long it will not contradict with the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad SAW, it's permissible. Is it considered that this is contradict to the Sunnah, Dr. Yahya?
No, this
That
not
most
this condition not contradict.
Type.
Why it's
Oh,
not
okay.
contradict? Why?
Type.
Because the woman is not obliged, okay, or forced to live with a man who have more than one wife. I mean, she has the right to live alone. Okay? But for example, if a woman said, okay, I will marry this man with a condition, my contract, that in case in the future that he decides to marry another woman, then I have the right to, you know, to get, to cancel this marriage contract. Now it's up here for whom? To the husband. If he said, okay, I agree to this and accepted this marriage contract with this condition, then what will happen in the future? In case that he planned or decided to marry another woman, that means he's violating this condition. Now, he will tell, I mean, this is now the right, the one who have the decision is who? The woman, because she's the one who put this condition. And he said, okay, now it is your choice. Either that I want to marry another woman, and you said that we want me to divorce you. So here it's come the decision of the woman. Either that she remake her thinking. I mean, try to think about other variables or other issues that exist later on. Like, for example, after 20 or 30 years, and she has kids, and there's no way to go out, and she preferred that to continue. And she said, okay, go ahead. You want to marry? Okay, but living with my kids, and okay, the marriage is okay. I waive my condition. Or she said, okay, no. I already made condition that you give me the right to divorce myself. And then you violated this condition. Therefore, she has the right to ask for divorce. I hope this is clear.
Clear. Jazakallah khair, Dr. Yahya.
That's
all for our chat box questions, Dr. Yahya.
Okay.
Participants, you may
Sister
unmute
Sarah, remember
now.
For tomorrow, okay?
Inshallah, Dr. Yahya.
Sister Sarah, okay, don't forget about announcement for our fiqh class tomorrow, inshallah.
Inshallah, Dr. Yahya.
Any question? No question? Okay, so we'll stop here. Jazakumullah khair. Anyway, anytime I have a question, you can send it or you can show it in next time. Barakallah feekum. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.